Raining Threes is sponsored by the Florida Gulf Coast University Foundation, supporting programs that advance student achievement, academic excellence, and community engagement. The law firm of Goldstein, Buckley, Seckman, Rice, and Pertz, personal injury attorneys, and neighbor since 1962. Justice starts now. Aerial Capital Advisors, LLC, providing comprehensive wealth management services to individuals and families in Southwest Florida. Jason's Deli, with 5 locations in Southwest Florida, offers catering and delivery for both lunch and dinner. And by Edison National Bank and Bank of the Islands, locally owned and managed and a proud supporter of Florida Gulf Coast University.
I've never been a part of a great environment like I am here at FGCU.
They were the rock of this athletic department from day one.
I think they're going to take us to some pretty exciting places.
A hometown favorite long before Dunk City, the FGCU women are now emerging on the national stage alongside NCAA giants.
I really just wanted to be a part of a winning program, and that's what I saw down here at FGCU.
My teammates are incredible. Every person who's here is genuine, nice, on and off the court.
We all love each other. We enjoy being around each other.
You have to appreciate a team that does things differently.
We don't look like many other teams offensively.
The teams that play FGCU don't play another team like FGCU on their schedule, within the conference or any other team on the planet.
They are really close to being a perennial Sweet 16 program.
We have to deserve this. We have to earn it.
They make it rain. They can knock down threes for days.
ASUN Player of the Year, Whitney Knight, hitting her first two shots, both of them from three.
The reigning threes mantra, it's been our calling card.
FGCU holds all the three-point records that there are.
It's like hitting home runs in baseball when you hit that three-pointer. It gets the crowd a little more pumped.
20 years, going to be the greatest coach in women's basketball history. Carl Smesko, remember the name. Remember the name. It's going to be better than Gino.
Today, it's easy to look at FGCU women's basketball as an emerging Division I force. But back at the program's inception in 2002, that was hardly the case.
We were working out of trailers, didn't have a gym. He had concrete and two hoops and went out and played basketball.
There are only so many really, really talented large girls to go around, and they go to the major programs for the most part.
Athletes nowadays love tradition. They love the Dukes, they love the Georgetowns, because there's history and there's a tradition there.
We didn't have any money. When we first started, we only had a couple scholarships. And we started out with a great gift of $5 million from Ben Hill Griffin, and that was really what catapulted us.
I was at a school that was just moving to Division I, and it's not easy to get Division I head coaching jobs. And a lot of people ask me, how could you go to a place that doesn't even have basketball yet? And I never really looked at it that way. I saw it as, how many times do you get to start a program from scratch?
Carl is he's a son of a coach, summa cum laude at Kent State. He's brilliant. He's absolutely brilliant.
His philosophy and his techniques of what he teaches are done in a way that are not traditional. Yet he is very traditional in terms of old school habits. I'm sure it comes from being around a dad who was a coach.
He had a real emphasis on fundamentals and discipline and toughness, and those things still are the cornerstones of every good program today.
Coach Smesko was a broadcast journalism major, so he was in line to do what I'm doing right now.
It's really interesting that Carl's a communications major, since he doesn't like to talk very often.
Smesko's not one to get too high or get too low. If we lose, he's not one to freak out too much. If we win, he's not one to, overcome. Sometimes when we win, you would think that we lost.
I got here my first year. I happened to see a picture of the 34-1 team that was runner-up in the Division II, and I couldn't believe it. Everybody was smiling with Carl. You would have thought they took the picture after the game, and he still was trying to get one more play in.
He has some good jokes sometimes, and sometimes he has some really bad jokes, but we still laugh at them, even if they're bad.
Whenever I show my butt to the ball, I'm closing down. Whenever I show my heart, I'm opening up. It's my heart.
Okay. When I first came here, there was no Alico Arena.
The challenge is, you are developing history.
When we got out there, it was just a bunch of trees. There were four buildings on campus and a bunch of trees and a vision.
I can remember walking out into those trees and grabbing one of the trees and ripping it out of the ground.
Smesco comes in with a tree one day in the trailer, and he said, "Boys, we're ready to start building." And that was it. That's when we started, Alico Arena started going up.
They were out beating the bushes, trying to find, you know, players to come and be the initial team here at FGCU.
It's about recruiting. That's what makes Smesco's job so tough and what makes him one of the best coaches in the country, is the fact that he is able to bring in some high quality athletes, but what he's able to get out of them is even better.
How were you able to attract players back in the early 2000s?
At first it was just showing them the dream. Some saw it, some didn't,
right.
But the ones who did, I think, really benefited of being a part of something special so early.
In the community, we had to prove ourselves so everybody would get behind us. We always told them, invest in us. You may be a Purdue fan or a Michigan fan. Take a zero off the end of what you give them. Give it to us, and we're going to do something special with it. And I think we did.
Their fan base is hardcore. I mean, they've got 2,000 fans that will show up on Christmas morning if that's when the FGCU women are playing.
Years ago, before the men's basketball program really got going, how, you know, we'd have doubleheaders, and we're playing the women's game second, really almost as a way to get some people to come watch the men.
After every game is over, Carl waves to the fans. First thing he does.
We've always included them as part of what we do, and I think they appreciate it, and they get to know the players a little bit and get to see them grow up, and excited to see them back at a game after they graduate. So it's just something we started, and really we haven't had to talk about it much after that. It's just what we do.
Come on down here and talk to our kids.
It means a lot to us, you know, to stay after the game and talk to them and hug them, because they give us so much energy.
Fans just adore that. We've got fans that really have taken ownership of these players. They feel like they know them, and they actually do know them. And it's just created an incredible closeness here.
You don't go to a lot of women's programs and see the kind of fans that we have and the relationships that we have with them. You know, we're family. We're all family here.
We know that they love us, so we want to go out and we want to play for them. And just knowing that they're behind us just really motivates us to work as hard as we can.
When you have fans that love you and cheer for you, man, you may be feeling tired with like 4 minutes to go, and you may be down by 2 or 3 points. But when there's the people you hear that go Eagles, that adrenaline can kick in and take you to another level.
Just to know that they care about you other than basketball, it's an amazing feeling. And I definitely think we have some of the greatest fans, you know, in college history of basketball.
Having impressively surmounted many of the program's initial challenges, one arcing question still remained. How could a David possibly compete with the Goliaths of the NCAA?
Coach Smesco had a purpose when he took the job early on, that we're not going to be able to succeed and accomplish the types of things that we want to do if we do it like everybody else.
He lives and breathes with 5'10", 5'11" players that can dribble and play defense and shoot the three.
It's not that he doesn't want a 6'6 post player, it's that he really can't get that.
Even though, like, we don't have the same like resources as some of the other schools, what we do have, we use it to the best of our ability.
We try to play smart throughout an entire game and not give away any possessions and make you play to your weaknesses while we play to our strengths.
Carl's felt that, you know, we can go with a different approach with the three-pointers and a different scheme that puts others at off balance in their normal routine.
FGCU's done it in an unorthodox way. Their offense is a beautiful thing to watch, but it's something that most coaches don't have the stomach for in terms of taking that risk.
I'm not sure that there are coaches out there as smart as Carl that would be able to implement such a complicated system.
The purpose of basketball is to get the defense off balance and keeping them there until you get a good shot. And FGCU exemplifies that wonderfully.
You cannot emulate his offense in a practice because you just can't.
FGCU usually plays with 5 guards on the court at the same time. They rarely pass the ball into the post, and they just about never take a shot that isn't a layup or a three-pointer.
That's what Carl Smesco has been doing for his whole career, spreading the floor, and he wants layups or three-pointers. I mean, why shoot anything else?
Shots from this area, the mid-range, pretty much never happen.
The mid-range jumper is the worst shot in the game.
The Eagles need dribble drives to be successful. That leads to layups and kickouts for three.
The three-point shot is very much the key to what they do, whether they shoot it or not, because it opens everything else up. FGCU usually has all five players who can shoot a three. And when they're open, they get yelled at if they don't shoot the three.
To create the kind of shots we want, we have to have five people working together, moving to create shots. And what I say the most is just move or screen or just getting kids to keep working and moving and making them guard some actions.
He runs a high motion offense, very, very unique sets.
Now everybody is slowly copying it. They don't run it the exact same way that he does. But more and more people are working outside in, and he was certainly one of the first to build an entire program on it.
We want players that really love basketball, that they're motivated and self-motivated at that, to get better, who want to learn the game.
We actually learn how to play basketball. We learn, like, the ins and outs. We learn all the details.
A pick and roll is a pick and roll, but his system's a little different than that.
A lot of times, individuals have to take a year or so almost to get used to how to run the offense that he has.
He teaches the game and understands the game at a level that most people can't comprehend.
He wants smart players. He's a teacher, but he only would prefer to teach it one or two times, not seven or eight.
It's not a system of being, you can't be selfish.
It's bigger than just you.
The players are unselfish, and you got to give credit to Coach Mesko for that. He's really gotten a great team buy-in from his gals.
They may have, you know, ponytails, and, you know, they smile a lot, and their grade point averages are outstanding, and so you think, oh, well, they're just, you know, nice players, nice women. They're tough.
I've never been one to really yell at players. We don't call kids names. But we do have a high expectation of what your level performance is.
If we're not doing what we're supposed to do, he's going to put us on the line, we're going to pay for it, and then we're going to get back out there and do what we need to do to win.
Every player that has bought into this system over the course of time has gotten better. It all goes back to Carl. It just really goes back to Carl.
A quality roster and capable helmsmen in place, the program worked its unique system, and accomplishments and acclaim began piling up.
Winning with good people and winning in exciting fashion is pretty much the staple of that program with a gentleman who's done it from scratch.
We've won a lot of conference championships, and then one of these is the regional championship when we were Division II. I think that was a, you know, a big moment for our program. That was the year we went to the national championship for Division II.
A few weeks ago when he got his 400th career victory, that was faster than Gino Auriemma at UConn. Just unbelievable. Our coach of the year once again, Carl Semesko.
Is there a certain satisfaction that you get from being able to launch a program from scratch and have it get in a little over a decade to where it is now, an NCAA tournament winning team?
I don't really look back at what we've done too often. I've always been, you know, the mindset of, you know, how no matter how beautiful the past is,
yeah,
it's always an ugly place to live. So I'm always thinking about the next thing, the next season, the next game.
After a decade spent tenaciously overcoming obstacles and pursuing excellence, the 2011-2012 Eagles finally reached the NCAA tournament, debuting at the Big Dance a full year before their men's counterparts. In 2014, the Eagles earned their second trip to the NCAA tournament. There, they suffered another heartbreaking first-round overtime loss, falling to Oklahoma State.
They just came at us hard and took it away.
Despite losing the program's all-time leading scorer, Sarah Hansen, the team retained the bulk of its veteran leadership, so the 2014-15 season was filled with promise.
The game was the second Saturday in January. First conference game of the year, they hosted Stetson. This was going to be Stetson's moment. They were going to topple FGCU, and they had them, led by 9 with 6.5 minutes to go. And then FGCU let them score 1 point the rest of the way, and the Eagles won again. And that changed everything. Those women realized, nobody's going to beat us. They only lost twice, and then they won 26 in a row.
They weren't winning a lot of those games by 2 to 5 points. They were winning by double digits and sometimes extreme double digits.
If we stay focused on the right things, it makes it possible for you to put together a streak when you're not really concerned about the streak, you're more concerned about day-to-day improvement.
A win in today's A-Sun final over Northern Kentucky will be FGCU's 30th of the season, and it will mean another banner gets lifted to the rafters here at Alico Arena.
And go out with a win and a championship and go into the NCAA tournament is the best feeling.
We feel like we can compete with the best teams in the nation, and we're going to come up with a game plan once we find out who we play and give it our best shot.
I played well and won a championship. I could clap a couple times, I guess.
So it was back to the big dance for a third time, and everyone was anxious to find out who they'd be paired with and where they'd play their first round game.
We're just anxious because we just don't know who we're going to get.
This is always one of the most exciting times when you know you're in the tournament and you just wait to see who your matchup is.
Number 14, Atlantic Sun Player of the Year, Whitney Knight.
We hope to see you guys out there if you can make it. Hopefully it's not too far. If it is, we would still like to see you guys out there supporting.
Wherever they go, we'll be there.
Something special starts right now. The 7-10 game, Florida Gulf Coast.
I honestly didn't even see what seed we were because I looked and I was like, wait, what? We're playing Oklahoma State again?
The game was close, only 5 hours away. We knew with how loyal our fans are that they would be right there supporting us and ready to cheer us on.
It's my dad, my biggest supporter, Big V, and this is my grandma.
I'm your supporter. I brag on you all the time.
Yeah, my supporter too.
This is our rematch. This is our time to show that we can compete at the highest level and that we are FGCU.
Straight up 75 and then hang a left on 10. The Eagles and their legion of fans descended upon Tallahassee.
It was the most exciting time of our basketball season because, I mean, it's the NCAA tournament.
It's FGCU all the way. We're excited, we're determined, and our girls are hot.
The girls are ready. Coach is ready. This is our year.
We're here at the Donald Tucker Center here in Tallahassee, Florida.
It's a third crack at an NCAA tournament victory for FGCU against an opponent they know all too well.
The year before, we kind of came out scared and dug ourselves a little bit of a hole, so we made a point that we weren't going to let that happen, that we were going to come out and fight from the beginning.
We felt like it was finally time to go ahead and get the win and not come back sad and feeling like, oh, we only lost by a couple points again.
It was a perfect matchup for the Eagles to prove that they had taken that next step.
We were ready to give them a run for their money.
Atwater on the drive, tough move, man.
Oklahoma State made a couple runs, and the game got tight a couple times. FGCU never really surrendered the lead. They played with confidence, like, we belong here. This is our day. They were terrific.
Pause with the three, yes!
Florida Gulf Coast, they came out and they got some vengeance.
I think we were all pretty jacked up about it, being back at the NCAA tournament again, getting another shot.
You could see the whole team was on the same page with what adjustments needed to be made from a year ago. And when they had an opportunity, they performed.
We had everybody go in there and do the role. We had Whitney and Kenesha go off, have amazing spring games. And we had people come in and contribute.
The Eagles looking to soar and put this one on ice.
With 6-7 minutes to go, we made one final push out, one really good run, and we were able to hold on after that.
Jenna Cobb late in the game kind of looked over at Coach.
She gave me the look like, Coach, we did it.
That's the first time I think I've ever saw him smile during a game.
It was really satisfying as a coach to see your players perform at such a high level.
In their third trip to the big dance, FGCU finally comes away with a win.
What a big victory for this program.
It was a great experience to be
in that moment.
This was the Eagles' first Division I tournament win in program history.
To do it with such an amazing group of girls and, you know, all of our fans behind us, that was probably the best feeling I've personally had ever in my basketball career.
Just knowing that we finally got one in the books for FGCU and that we made history and we were the first team to do it, it was just awesome.
They performed on that stage, and it was a day 13 years in the making.
Hearing Coach tell us how proud he was of us, that was a big sense of like pride in ourselves.
He also made a point that we had to get ready for the next game. He said, we didn't just come here to win one game. We came here to see how many games we can win.
We're on to the next challenge. You know, this would be an incredible moment if we were able to beat a team of this caliber on their home court.
For as good a draw as FGCU got in the first round, that's as bad a draw as they got having to play Florida State.
A lot of tradition, a lot of height, a lot of athleticism.
We definitely want to get the game plan right, because with our game plan, we will give ourselves a great opportunity to win the games.
The additional challenge is just how quick the turnaround is.
The short break might actually be an advantage for FGCU because it gives the Seminoles less of a chance to prepare for their unique offense.
The way that our team plays, shooting a high percentage from the three-point range, that's kind of the great equalizer for us with a lot of the teams that we played that may be taller, more athletic, that type of thing. So I would never count us out.
We just had to get our minds right and get as prepared as we could to play Florida State.
They knew this was a step up in class.
Despite the 26-game winning streak, the Eagles assumed the role of underdog tonight, up against the seasoned second-seeded Seminoles on their home floor in front of their large and loud crowd.
I thought if they played a near-perfect game, I really thought they could pull this off.
Florida Gulf Coast Eagles hoping to soar tonight as they did in their opening round game. Atwater was the high score in the previous game. The conference player of the year is Whitney Knight. And we are underway. Sweet 16 berth is on the line.
From the jump, Florida State's players were bigger, faster, and stronger. And they made a point to prove that in the beginning by pushing around FGCU.
They missed some open shots that they would normally hit.
We thought they were going to push it inside the entire time. Well, they were making all of their outside shots.
Brown again from downtown. Well, she's 2 for 2. Knight wide open for 3, and she quiets the crowd.
After the first few minutes, we settled down. We took care of the ball, and we got a lot of good shots.
Taylor Gratigan knocks down a 3. The Eagles are clawing back.
Yeah. I think they had a shot, pun intended, if they made their 3-pointers. It was all going to be predicated on that.
FGCU pulls to within 6. The Eagles had a couple of shots to get closer, but they didn't go.
They were jittery offensively, and you usually see that with layups, and they missed 15 of them.
If that would have changed, that one simple factor, no question it's a close game.
Against a Florida State team, you know, a team of that high caliber, you cannot have an off-shooting day.
Florida Gulf Coast with its last possession of the season here. A very appropriate way to end it all with a 3-ball.
The toughest part of it was knowing that we didn't play up to our standards, knowing that there was a lot of things that we could have done differently.
So the Atlantic Sun champs will lose here, and Florida State University Seminoles will advance to the Sweet 16.
The FGCU Eagles' journey in the NCAA tournament ended tonight. The women's basketball team fell to Florida State 65-47.
It's like David trying to take on Goliath, you know, and fortunately they didn't have enough juice.
Just one win shy of the Sweet 16. The Eagles had indeed soared to new heights. FGCU women's basketball now has a history, one that elite players are finding attractive. With Coach Semesco at the helm, it's likely it won't be long before the Eagles match, if not surpass, the glory the men's team achieved in 2013. But how long will Carl Semesco hold the title of FGCU women's only head coach?
I don't know why he's still here, to be honest. I mean, the guy is so dang good.
I've covered Nealon Richardson, I've covered Gene Cady, I've covered Bob Knight. Carl Semesco may be the best X and O's coach that I've ever been around in my lifetime.
He could challenge for the all-time wins record, to be honest with you.
With all the success that you've had over a decade span of time, I'm sure your phone rings somewhat regularly with bigger schools showing interest in you. What do you say when you get those phone calls?
Well, I usually start with hello.
Everybody knows that college coaching is one of those things where when you have success and you get interest from other teams, and then you possibly leave because there's more money out there in different universities.
The only thing that would interest me is something where you'd say, hey, you got a chance to win national championships year in and year out.
My goal is to retire in a time when either Carl's retiring at the same time or, you know, Carl retires a few years later and there's a statue of him out in front of the arena.
This year it's especially easy to be loyal because nobody's contacted me.
FGCU can only look up into the heavens and go, thank you. Thank you.
So FGCU and its fans can rejoice. Coach Domesko is once again at the helm, and this could be the season that the Eagles make their deepest tournament run yet.
We say it every year that this could be the best one yet, but this really could be the best year yet.
Let's be real here. There's a lot that is coming back, and the next season really could be the culmination of everything he's worked for in terms of a team that could win not one, but two, maybe three NCAA tournament games.
It's only right that we push up the goals, which would be like trying to go to the Sweet 16.
The standards and the expectations keep raising, and we want those expectations, and we want to try to meet them.
Don't be surprised if they achieve even more than what they achieved last year, which is saying something.
FG! We love you guys! Yes!